going to say a few things about the South African Society for Psychical Research that you might or probably have not yet heard about. The schedule still says South African Society for Parapsychology. The official name was Psychical Research. Just one or two T's and C's. I mean, before I get started, the session is about exploiting the ill, the vulnerable, and the ignorant. The topic I'm going to discuss is kind of speaks more about towards the pseudoscience, but then the quackery, really. So it's not so much about the exploitation of the ill or the vulnerable, but much more the ignorant, really. And then a second thing I wanted to mention is quite a bit of a sort of deep history. Yeah, that this is a society that existed a few decades ago, so it's not maybe not quite as topical as some of the previous talks. So it's going to be lots of historical data, some of it quite odd. And you can decide for yourself what to make with it, you know, whether you find an argument in there. And then the last thing I wanted to mention, just to get it out of the way, this is all data and research that I sort of came across when I was researching a book a few years ago. It was published, it was a popular book about occult movements in South Africa in the 20th century. It ended up sort of being lots of research about the spiritualism movement in the early half of the previous century, as well as parapsychology, which was quite a big thing around the middle of the 20th century. So it's work it has not yet been published in any academic format. So it was more a popular publication. So maybe just to keep that in mind, I'll hope not to practice any quackery or pseudoscience myself as I go through it. I wanted to start by maybe just, because it's history, just referring quickly to the case of three really illustrious scientists from the previous century in South Africa. Yeah, so there's this one, and I don't know if many of you will recognize Prof. Dr. Yuri Salihisagakema. Most of you might not recognize the face of this man, but you probably might recognize this face in his one hand there, and that's the well-known Mrs. Pless, a Stilopithecus Africanus, who was unearthed in the 1940s in Sterkfontein, in the cradle of mankind. Dr. Brim, who is the archaeologist who found Mrs. Pless, some people say Mr. Pless nowadays, apparently, but it was back then still Mrs. Pless from all we knew back then. Probably, I would say, the eminent name in archaeology, I would think, in the previous century in South Africa. I mean, he has the very unusual honor among scientists of having a major road named after him in the West Rand in Gauteng. He used to actually be a professor of zoology at this institute when it was still called the Victoria College in the first decade of the previous century. Eventually, sort of went on to work much more in sort of digging up mammalian fossils in the Karoo area, and for which he became a fellow of the Royal Society. But then his big breakthrough was when he discovered Mrs. Pless, the fossil, in Sterkfontein, and what was the year? I made a note of it. Yeah, 1935. Yeah, which really sort of after the Taung child, I mean, this has really helped us, and it was a much more complete skeleton. It helped us a lot in picturing sort of drawing the picture of human evolution. What's not on that signal on that slide though is an interesting bit of his history. While he was sort of working in the Northern Cape doing his excavations in the town of Freiburg, I don't know how many of you have been there, he came across a sort of spiritualist society that used to meet there. Spiritualism, for those of you who don't know, these people who sit around the table with their hand palms and then the table knocking and conjure the undead. And this group was run by a local young farmer called Johannes Loopser and a local printer man by the name of Willem Pretorius. And Dr. Brim was quite enamored of them. He got quite involved with them. They would sit down and they would conjure the spirits of well-known dead people, including the novelist Arthur Conan Doyle and spiritual beings. And he was actually instrumental in encouraging them to publish a book about their experiences, for which he wrote the foreword. He himself eventually wrote a book by the name of Coming of Man, Was It Accident or Design?, in which he avowed natural selection and said that the driving force behind human evolution was spiritual guides that had sort of guided the human species along. He also confessed in the book that sometimes at the times of his digs he would at night hold seances and get advice from the spirits on where to dig next, so some spirits might have helped us find Mrs. Pless. But it's a kind of interesting case study for me in the sense of a reminder that even among the most illustrious scientists, a bit of pseudoscientific ideas can creep in there. Second person I can probably will know, the older one people might know this face, the much beloved and well-known Dr. Arthur Blexley, who's probably or maybe even certainly the most prominent astronomer in South Africa ever. He used to be professor of applied mathematics at University Witwatersrand. A very well-known man, also instrumental in the founding of the planetarium. He was popularly known as Mr. Science at one point for his very frequent radio talks and writing some public and popular magazines about science. He actually had letters with his findings published in Nature on three occasions. So quite a prominent guy. What is not so well... there's a lecture series named after him at Wits University today. What's not so well known about him is he'd also published this kind of thing sometimes. That's from Die Brandwacht, which is an old Afrikaans language family magazine, no longer in existence, to whom he used to write articles about ghosts and whether there's any scientific base to it. And, you know, he'd go ghost hunting and visit haunted houses and then write sort of write-ups about it, the likelihood of it being ESP and the likelihood of it being actual spooks floating around. He was also the first chairperson of what I'm going to discuss more about, the South African Society of Psychical Research, for which, among other things, he did original research on the phenomenon of telepathy during sleep, which he was the first person ever to investigate worldwide, apparently, and he got a medal from Duke University for that. A third person, maybe not as well known as the chap sitting right in the middle of that story, Dr. Bernard Lobsters. I don't know how many people might remember that name. He had a bit of a profile as a scientist in the previous century as well. His story was interesting. He was a Carnegie Fellow back in the 1920s, 30s, and he studied in Glasgow in the United States, medicine and psychiatry. Came back and was assigned to what was then known as the Native Ward in the psychiatric hospital in Queenstown. And he, wanting to apply some of his psychoanalysis to the people from Amakosa background, decided that he would need to understand the culture a bit better and did a really amazing field work. That's where the picture comes from, in Fingoland and Temboland there, and wrote wonderful field studies about the culture there, but also eventually sort of made his name in local psychiatric circles. He became the chairperson of the National Red Cross, among other things. Not so well remembered, but among other things he wrote, he was also a very enthusiastic spiritualist. Wrote two books, Beyond Life's Curtain was the one, and In Quest of the Unseen. He also postulated the Poltergeist Neanderthal thesis. If anybody wants to know what that is, I'll explain. He subscribed to the idea that ghosts were entities left behind by dead people. But he especially also researched what's called poltergeist, in Afrikaans was called Goelgeester back then. And these are the ghosts that come into your house that are quite sort of more violent. They slam doors and throw around cups and, you know, grate their nails on the roofs. And he postulated and actually accepted as well the idea that while all ghosts are the remnants of dead people, poltergeists specifically must be very old ghosts left behind by Neanderthals or even Homo erectus who died in a specific spot and who were quite uncultured and violent, and that's why those ghosts were so violent. So that was an idea that he published happily. So why I'm showing all these people is not just to be odd, but sort of where I want to go with this talk is when we talk about the ignorant who are prey to the dangers of pseudoscience, it is often very easy to get together and be quite self-congratulatory and bemoan the fact of the scientifically illiterate public outside who so easily fall for pseudoscience. But it's sometimes also, I think, important for us to remind ourselves that the most scientifically literate among us can sometimes, for a variety of reasons that one could explore, sometimes also fall for some things that are not that sound. And that it has happened to people who are definitely my scientifically superior. So, I mean, yeah, that's where I want to go. So the story that I really wanted to tell was just the story, a little bit of background just about spiritualism, because it's important. Some of you might know this, some not, but the history of spiritualism really comes from 1847, back in the town of Hydesville, New York City. It's quite close to the city of Rochester, upstate, where there was a house outside of the town of Hydesville occupied by a family by the name of Fox, devout Methodists. And they used to hear weird knocking, rapping sounds in their house at night. And the two young girls, this is them taken when they were much older, but then they were 9 and 12 years old, respectively, Catherine and Margaret, worked out a crude kind of a Morse code and started to communicate with an entity making rapping sounds in their houses. And then this entity, this is I don't believe this, but this is the story they told them. But this entity would communicate to them that it was actually a dead spirit of somebody who died there. And so it became quite a fad in the community. Other people would come to this house and they'd conjure these dead people. And after a while, people in other houses started hearing these sounds as well, spread all the way through the state, spread all the way through the country. And that was the birth of the spiritualism fad. Now, spiritualism is not just people who encounter ghosts, but people who, and you can see the scientific mindset, 1800s arising, people who employed a specific method in order to conjure up the dead. The method would include something like a Ouija board that some of them used, or sitting around the table with your palms flat, letting the table shake, using the glass that you might have been warned against at Sunday school to find the letters. It became quite popular by 1852, and it spread to London. And from London, well-known mediums by names of D.D. Holme and so on, much of this is forgotten, carried it around Europe, Russia, France, everywhere, the Netherlands. The first records of it in Cape Town is 1874 already, when there was a spiritualist society founded in Cape Town, with their own spiritualist publication came out once a month or so. By the 1900s, time of the Boer War, it was already up in the Boer Republics, the Free State, and the Old Transvaal, where many sort of well-known folks participated. It's been kind of typical from history, but even the Boer general, General de la Rey, used to sit at the tables and conjure them up, and people like Johanna Brandt, and sort of the literate set as well, C. Louis Leipold, and those types of folks. What happened, though, as spiritualism was arising, there was inevitably, you know, these Victorian gentlemen of science became curious about it and wanted to pursue it in a more scientific way. And so already in 1882, the Society for Psychical Research was found in London. Some of the founders, they had names that were well-known. I don't recognize too many of them today anymore, but in their day, they were well-known. Folks like William Crookes and Oliver Lodge were involved. One name that some people might still remember, Henri Bergson, the philosopher, many of them got involved with it. And they, interesting, that's a quote from their founding documents. They were to investigate mesmerism, phrenology, phrenomesmerism, which sounds interesting, clairvoyance, electricity, galvanism, magic arts, pagan mysteries, and other occult phenomena. And the big work that they did was what they called the Census of Hallucinations, 1892, when about 17,000 people were in the sample, were asked this question: have you ever, when believing yourself to be completely awake, had a vivid impression of seeing or being touched by a living or inanimate object, or hearing a voice which impression, as far as you could discover, was not due to an external cause? And 9.9% of people said yes. Now, I mean, as you can see, it's quite a crude research method. I mean, what could you possibly deduce from that? So it's not surprising that very soon the people wanted to do something a bit more rigorous, a bit more quantitative, for instance. And all sorts of tools came up. I mean, there's already in one of that 1874 publication in the Cape that I mentioned, there's this, it's probably too small for you to see, but it's a record of a thing called the planchette, which was a tool that you could use to spell out letters of spiritual communication. And a man recounts how he and a friend in Bloemfontein, in 1874 Bloemfontein, imagine that, did an experiment where his friend would sit down, close eyes with this planchette, and then he would put a finger on his shoulder and he would telepathically send messages through and have it spelt out on the paper. So you can see there's a kind of a urge for a scientific method coming up there. But it really became, for lack of a better word, respectable in the 1940s when Dr. J.B. Ryan, and there's quite an interesting thing to look up, at Duke University in the USA, started the first parapsychological laboratory. He also changed the name from psychical research, which sounded very very spiritual, to parapsychology, which then linked it to the discipline of psychology, which had at least had some esteem back then. This big innovation was the founding of the Zener cards, a chip some of you might have seen. So it's these five cards, with one with a star, one with a block, one with a wave, and then that's Dr. Ryan at the top there. You could do quantitative studies because you could sit down and so one person would be a sender. They would look at this and concentrate on one of the cards, and then some person would be the receiver, and they would sort of gauge from there what one you were looking at by telepathy, and then they could do hundreds and thousands of these and then statistically work out whether there is any variance from what random guesswork would be. He was quite optimistic. He said at one point one of his subjects guessed all. There's 25 cards in the sequence. He said at one point one of his students guessed all 25 cards correctly, of which he calculated, and I was too lazy to check the sum, that the statistical odds of it was 298,000,023,000, etc., etc. I don't know if that number is correct, but that's what he calculated. I think if you play poker, you can already probably see that there's a bit of a fault in the methodology there. But this became quite popular and sort of it became the benchmark of parapsychology. The criticisms of it was, I mean, things like the almost near impossibility of perfect randomness. Né? I mean, you could think you're shuffling cards and you can think that, but there's really not even... Especially, I mean, even today we don't have software that can do perfect randomness. There's no indication of the method by which ESP would have functioned. So you can postulate a statistical correlation between what person's thinking and what the other one is writing down, but how do you propose that that communication happened? There was often procedural flaws. I mean, there was no replacement protocol for cards being replaced as one was being scanned, so the same cards were coming back, and then non-repeatability. Quite a few institutions tried to repeat his experiments, but none of it seemed to have worked. This includes like Princeton, Southern Methodist, and Brown University, a few others. But just to bring it to South Africa, I mean, we had a few early parapsychologists, the well-known Dr. Louis Leipold, after whom the hospital was named in the northern suburbs, was also quite an enthusiastic parapsychologist, but he was of the first generation for who it was more kind of ghost hunting. So he would go to ghost haunted houses and go make notes of the ramblings in the roof and that kind of thing. And then T.J. Haroff, whose name might be not that well remembered, he was professor of classical languages in Wits way back. Latinist nodding in the back there. Also, one of the early Afrikaans authors. He had actually quite an interesting argument. He was not that keen on parapsychology, even though he liked ghost hunting. He said, well, I think it's actually a reasonably good argument. He said that, spiritual entities, as he understood it, being non-material, it's not that sensible to use the methods of material science to try and investigate non-material entities, and it couldn't possibly work. So that was his argument. But it didn't stop the founding of the South African Society of Psychical Research, which is actually what I wanted to get to. So in 1954, probably inspired by the work of Ryan and others, a group of very enthusiastic intellectuals and academics got together in Johannesburg, and founded the South African Society for Psychical Research based on the example from London. Now, their first lecture started in 1955, and it was done by Dr. Blixley, mentioned a while ago. His topic, as you can already see, was quite hopeful, the quantitative method in parapsychology. So his hope was that apart from just looking at sort of getting impressions and anecdotes and those kinds of things, could people do statistical studies and find something a bit more rigorous happening and see what they could prove. The first chairperson was Professor Marius Falkoff, who was the professor of romance languages at Wits. But they had all the really interesting, the trappings the signs of decent science. And what's interesting, also much more of hard science rather than the human sciences. The later chairperson was Professor Jeroen van der Merwe, who was also a professor of mathematics from Stellenbosch University. They were housed in the Department of Applied Mathematics at University of Witwatersrand. So these were hard science folks, not just us superstitious humanity folks. They also had the Falkoff Medal that was awarded once a year for outstanding work in parapsychology. It was actually awarded in 1 year. That's quite interesting. It was awarded to another mathematician from Wits, Professor Michael Whiteman, who in 1969 did research on the relationship between LSD and ESP. And it says in the papers, Professor Marius Falkoff was brave enough to submit himself to these tests. And what apparently happened is he dropped LSD and then went astral traveling. And so they postulated a relationship between astral traveling and the use of LSD, which I don't think you need to do a study to know. In 1973, they did an academic conference, Parapsychology in South Africa, the papers of which are fascinating to read. I mean, some works, Poynton did a fascinating survey on astral traveling in South Africa. Dr. Bernard Lobsher, that I mentioned earlier, he was there, did a bit of sort of local South African beliefs on the supernormal. As an illustration of how they work, stop me when I've run out. As an illustration of how they went to work, I mean, Dr. Bleaksley himself presented a paper on a fascinating case of a Mr. Van Vierde, who was a Dutchman living in South Africa. He'd been traumatized in Indonesia because he was there during the invasion by Japan in the Second World War, and he spent time in an internment camp. And he said after that he had the ability of reading, very useless ability of reading the time on a distant clock while he was asleep. So what they would do is every night when he went to sleep, he was in Cape Town, Dr. Bleaksley would set his clock to a random time, and then they would check whether this man was able to wake up at that specific time. And apparently, eight out of the 27 nights, he woke up within a five-minute window of that time, which they saw as statistically significant. So that was published. So anyway, it kind of fizzled out towards the 1970s. Nobody's sure when it actually stopped. But I find it fascinating to know that in the 1960s, who would have guessed, man? People in Johannesburg were doing these studies of LSD and ghosts and astral traveling. Anyway, but now, this is that being a media scholar, I also looked up how this was the reception of this in the media, and that's where it gets interesting, because this is an article how Huisgenoot magazine, the country's largest magazine, reported on it, and they said, slim manne gaan die voorbeeld is uitleer, translates as, clever men will analyze your premonitions. And the entire article, if you read through it, is all about poltergeists and materializations and ectoplasm, and there's very little mention of ESP. So where these guys were obviously hoping to give their subject some scientific presentability by focusing on quantitative studies of psychological methods, it was kind of seen in here as a validation of larger fields of supernaturalism and ghost busting and that kind of a thing. A second example, Mrs. Elian Rabi, a well-known psychic in the previous century, wrote her memoirs, and she was one of the test subjects that they studied at the Psychical Research, and she kind of mentions the studies they did on her as a kind of an indication that her work was valid and was even scientifically highly regarded, and then sees that as a kind of a validation for also the story she tells about past life regression, going back to the Boer War and communicating with animals, etc. So we're talking about danger, and I don't think the Society for Parapsychological Society for Psychical Research were necessarily maybe harmed anything. It might just have been a bunch of harmless guys up in Johannesburg wanting to do a bit of fun. But it seems to me that there is a kind of what's interesting process, that folks have a kind of side hobby interest in something paranormal. They pursue it, and then the fact that a scientist gets involved in it, is seen by the broader public as a validation of a wider field of paranormal claims. To kind of give you a more dangerous example is this very tragic one that I think many of you are familiar with. Dr. Linus Pauling, twice Nobel Prize winner, who did wonderful work, but at some point started to develop quite bonkish ideas about nutrition and healing. And once those ideas were out in the open, then really dangerous quacks, the likes of Dr. Matthias Rath, who'd been mentioned earlier, or Nathan, your friend, or Dr. Holford, would then jump on this and see his claims as a validation of their really dangerous attacks on classical nutrition, or, you know, their really unfounded claims. So I think that maybe there's something. What does one deduce from that? I don't know if I should say. It might be that scientists need to watch their step a little carefully, especially because when those of you representing the scientific elite, meddle with this, it can very easily be seen as permission to go on all sorts of more dangerous tangents. I was going to mention all sorts of local names, but then I thought better of it. So that's pretty much it. That's just a lot of information. I mean, make of it what you want. I think it's a very interesting bit of history that not that many people know of, but I think it's also a bit of a wake-up call, just to think that we should never think that we have arrived at a spot where we aren't at risk. That's it. Thank you.